Yeah, but that one, Nehemiah, was cold too. Nehemiah 14, it says, as it was going toward evening, he locked the gates. So that shows you that evening started the, exactly. Sabbath. Yep, yep, and yep. He said, leave them closed until the end of the Sabbath.
The other one that was John 9. Remember what John 9 said? Before the evening, because wasn't no buying or selling.
On the Sabbath, right. Did he check your mic? Mine is green, this song, right?
Yeah. Yeah, we good.
Tested 1, 2. Tested 1, 2. I got to talk first, Cora.
Yeah, we good.
All right, everybody, we're going to get started. We're going to stand, face the rules, and we're going to open up. They can hear you. Hold on. Okay.
Teach me, O Lord.
Teach me, O Lord.
The way of thy statutes.
The way of thy statutes.
And I shall keep it until the end.
And I shall keep it until the end.
Give me understanding.
Give me understanding.
And I shall keep thy law.
And I shall keep thy law.
Yea.
Yea.
I shall observe it with my whole heart.
I shall observe it with my whole heart.
Make me to go in the path of thy commandments.
Make me to go into the path of thy commandments.
For therein do I delight.
For therein do I delight.
Incline my heart unto thy testimonies.
Incline my heart unto thy testimonies.
And not to covetousness.
And not to covetousness.
Turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity.
Turn away my eyes from beholding vanity.
And quicken thou me in thy way.
And quicken thou me in thy way.
Establish thy word unto thy servant.
Establish thy word unto thy servant.
Who is devoted to thy fear.
Who is devoted to thy fear.
Turn away my reproach which I fear.
Turn away my reproach which I fear.
For thy judgments are good.
For thy judgments are good.
Behold.
Behold.
I have longed after thy precepts.
I have longed after thy precepts.
Quicken me in thy righteousness.
Quicken me in thy righteousness.
I just read to you Psalms chapter 119, verses 33 through 40. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Okay, this is the beginning of a new month for us here. So at the beginning of the month, we always call out all the different locations that are members of the COI or Church of Israel. Mike Rich. But while we're doing that, then he's just going to go ahead and read these names here of all the different memberships out around the country.
Good now. Birmingham, Alabama. Roanoke, Alabama. Phoenix, Arizona. Surprise, Arizona. Antelope, California. California City, California. Coronados, California. Fair Oaks, California. Fresno, California. Long Beach, California. Los Angeles, California. Mill Pizzas, California. Oakland, California, Oxnard, California, Rancho Cordova, California, Sacramento, California, Torrance, California, Aurora, Colorado, Red Feather Lakes, Colorado, East Hartford, Connecticut, Fort Pierce, Florida, Gainesville, Florida, Highland Beach, Florida, Indian Harbor Beach, Florida, Melbourne, Florida, NW Palm Bay, Florida, Orlando, Florida, Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, Port St. Lucie, Florida, Tampa Bay, Florida, Fairborn, Georgia, Fort Valley, Georgia, Louisville, Georgia, Marietta, Georgia, Smyrna, Georgia, Danville, Illinois, Rockford, Illinois, Woodridge, Illinois, Hammond, Indiana, Muncie, Indiana, New Albany, Indiana, Kansas City, Kansas, Overland Park, Kansas, Franklin, Kentucky, Louisville, Kentucky, Jackson, Louisiana, Brooks Bridge, Louisiana, Hammond, Louisiana, Harvey, Louisiana, Lafayette, Louisiana, New Orleans, Louisiana, Cambridge, Maryland, Columbia, Maryland, Hyattsville, Maryland, Owings Mills, Maryland, Parkville, Maryland, Baltimore, Maryland, Reisterstown, Maryland, Boston, Massachusetts, Dorchester, Massachusetts, Novi, Michigan, Detroit, Michigan, Flint, Michigan, Southfield, Michigan, Whitehall, Michigan. Brooklyn Center, Minnesota. Maplewood, Minnesota. Minneapolis, Minnesota. St. Paul, Minnesota. Cortland, Mississippi. Vicksburg, Mississippi. St. Louis, Missouri. Las Vegas, Nevada. Columbus, New Jersey. Cape May, New Jersey. Hightstown, New Jersey. Hamilton Square, New Jersey. Albuquerque, New Mexico. Rio Rancho, New Mexico. Albany, New York. Bronx, New York. Harlem, New York. Latham, New York. Newburgh, New York. Rosedale, Queens, New York. Cary, North Carolina. Castle Hayne, North Carolina. Charlotte, North Carolina. Dallas, North Carolina. Fayetteville, North Carolina. Fremont, North Carolina. Gastonia, North Carolina. Greensboro, North Carolina. Jacksonville, North Carolina. Fafetown, North Carolina. Princeville, North Carolina. Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Wilmington, North Carolina. Akron, Ohio. Beaver Creek, Ohio. Cano, Winchester, Ohio. Cleveland Heights, Ohio. Columbus, Ohio. Dayton, Ohio. Des Moines, Ohio. Groveport, Ohio. Parma Heights, Ohio. Pastacala, Ohio. University Heights, Ohio. Youngstown, Ohio. Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Dixon, Tennessee. Dixon, Tennessee. Knoxville, Tennessee. Nashville, Tennessee. Springfield, Tennessee. Clarksville, Tennessee. Allen, Texas. Brookshire, Texas. Bryan, Texas. Carrollton, Texas. Corpus Christi, Texas. Friendswood, Texas. Garland, Texas. Houston, Texas. Lancaster, Texas. McKinney, Texas. Missouri City, Texas. San Antonio, Texas. Alexandria, Virginia. Ashburn, Virginia. Chesapeake, Virginia. Tacoma, Washington. Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Waterloo, Canada. Kitchener, Canada. Ontario, Canada. Toronto, Ontario, Canada. Deluxe, Republic of Ireland. County Meath, Ireland. Moran, Spain. Hayes, England, United Kingdom. London, England, United Kingdom. Derby City, England, United Kingdom. Derbyshire, England, United Kingdom. Queensland, Australia. Renault, Colliers, Australia. Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. That's 20 more cities.
Okay. Obviously, we are an international organization, and that's a beautiful thing. The reason why we do read these cities and states is so that people out there, you know that you have somebody that you might be able to communicate with, some people you may be able to have a feast with during the feast days. If we didn't call your name or your city and state, then you probably want to give us a call and let us know. You may need to update your membership information, but that's what the purpose of that is for. I do want to thank the Lord that I'm able to appear before you today, and that it is an honor to do that. This is the beginning of Black History Week, and we're going to go over a lot of things that show what the role of the black man, if you will, or the black woman in the Bible is, and how they're important to us as well as to the world, as well as to the Lord. And the main thing is that we are talking about the name Israel. So Israel is a name that was given to Jacob. He was adopted by the Lord, and all of his patriarchs, the name of Israel became their last name. So that's why you have names like John the Baptist, or you have people that are named different things, but their last name was always Israel. And that's because they were adopted by the Lord giving his name, which is a name that most people don't know when you talk about the common day or regular Christianity. All they know is Jesus, the New Testament Jesus, but they don't know the Jesus of this Bible. And the Jesus of this Bible exists in both the Old and the New Testament. So if you're just a New Testament Christian, you're missing out on the whole thing, because the book does say, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to that, then there is no light in them. And then for a more sure word, you have the Old Testament to deal with. But in essence, you have this book. And this book here, to me, is the best black history book you're gonna run across in your life. This is the diary of Shem and his interactions with his two brothers, Ham and Japheth. And it goes on throughout this whole process, giving us examples of what to do and what not to do. The key here is to be obedient, That is the reference to the covenant or to the contract. If you are obedient to the Lord, then he will reward you with eternal life. If you're not in obedience with the Lord, then you will end up in the lake of fire. It's pretty much that simple. So why is God worried about man so much? He's trying to create himself. So in order to recreate himself, he has to have people of like mind and of like conscience. And if you're not in that mindset, then frankly, you don't have a chance. So what was the role of the black man in this Bible or the black woman in this Bible? The covenant here was to become the priest for the Lord, to handle the services of his sanctuaries, and to spread his truth throughout the entire world. That's Revelation 1 and 1. The revelation is given by the Father to the Son. The Son gave it to an angel, and the angel gave it to man to give to the rest of the sons of Adam or to Noah, whichever way you want to look at it. But first of all, you got to get everybody across the flood. So who can you get across the flood? Just Shem, Ham, and Japheth. So these three brothers are the ones that repopulated the entire earth, and this is where we have to build our foundation from. So from there, we have who? Abraham, right? Who is the father of the faith. Now, Abraham is the father of Esau, he's the father of Ishmael, and he's also the father of Isaac. But in order to understand the role of the Lord, you have to follow the promises. So you have to follow Abraham, you have to follow Isaac, and then you have to follow Jacob. You don't follow Esau, you don't follow Buddha, and you don't follow Ishmael. So why is it so important that we deal with this situation from this book? And that's because we can understand the promises as they flow through this book, and we're going to cover all of that. But I want to make sure everybody understands that we are Hebrew Israelites. We're Hebrew as a result of Abraham, but we're Israelites because of the adoption of Jacob, whose name we'll find out later became Israel. All right? So let's start this off in Acts, the 7th chapter. We're going to start off with the promises. So I think we covered everything now. We're going to start this off in Acts, the 7th chapter. And we're going to pick it up at verse 2. Acts 7 and verse 2. And this is stepping, basically giving out a chronological order how this whole thing came into play. So we're going to be in and out of Acts 7 and probably Genesis 15 for the beginning part of this lesson. So pick it up at verse 2. Go ahead.
And he said, "Men, brethren, and fathers, hearken. The God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia, before he dwelt in Charan.
Go ahead.
And said unto him, Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and come into the land which I shall show thee."
So he's going to show them a land. Go ahead.
"Then came he out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Charan. And from thence, when his father was dead, he removed him into this land wherein ye now dwell."
Go ahead.
"And he gave him none inheritance in it." No, not so much as to set his foot on. Yet he promised that he would give it to him for a possession and to his seed after him, when as yet he had no child.
So he's promising Abraham here something. He's promising him this land. And it's so clear sometimes when you recite the Lord's Prayer, it said, "Thy kingdom come, thy shall be done on earth as it is in heaven." But because we have blown the mission as the teachers, priests, and ministers of this doctrine, the world now thinks that you'd go to heaven at death. But yet we can't prove that. They themselves can't prove it, and they have a great deal of confusion, because if a person goes to heaven or to hell at death, then why do we have a grave? And why do you visit a grave to talk to that person if they're already taken or they're already gone? Well, just to put it all in a nutshell, when Jesus resurrected and returned to the Father, he left absolutely nothing behind. No bone, no skeletal, no flesh or anything. But when we die, we still have a substance there that will deteriorate over time. And it will actually return to where it came from, which is what?
Dust.
Dirt. Yeah. And that's Genesis 2 and 7. Man was made from the dust of the ground and became a living soul once the breath of life was breathed into him. So he became a living soul, but again, we are made from dirt. All right? So let's move on here and clarify this promise a little bit more. Let's go to Genesis, the 15th chapter. And this is basically the covenant of the circumcision that was given unto Abraham and to his seed, and that they shall inherit the land for a possession. So David will sit on the Lord will sit on the throne of his father David. David did not have a throne in heaven. He had a throne in Hebron and in Jerusalem. So if Jesus is going to sit on that throne, he's got to come back here. So that is totally contrary to what common doctrine teaches today. But I have to say this real quick. We have this understanding because we can read this book like it's our ABCs. Why is that the case? Because we have the oracles. And the oracles are basically the answer from God. And we're gonna touch on some of that as we go through this. But if you think that it's an oxymoron, if the Gentiles thought that they had this secret and they had it so well, they would not change it, and they have not. But they cannot look at this book and read it like we read it. We know that an evening and a morning start today. They have 12 o'clock a.m. to 12 o'clock p.m. We know that there's a dietary law. Most of these congregations tomorrow will be eating anything that goes across their table. So they don't have any restrictions. There's so many other red flags. They do the first day of the week rather than the seventh day of the week. So these are red flags, or what I would call deceptions. And that is why the world is in the predicament that it is today. So, and we will touch upon those curses that came upon us because we had this together, but we blew the mission by turning unto other gods, wanting to be seen of men, pride, etc. So let's pick this up at Genesis 15 and verse 1. Go ahead.
After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, "Fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward."
Okay, so Abraham has a relationship, a personal relationship with the Lord. Go ahead.
And Abram said, "Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eleazar of Damascus?"
Okay, so no one even of his seed is the heir of his house. Go ahead.
And Abram said, "Behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir." And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, "This shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir."
Okay.
And he brought him forth abroad and said, "Look now toward heaven and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them." And he said unto him, "So shall thy seed be." And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. And he said unto him, "I am the Lord that brought thee out of Ur of the Chaldees to give thee this land to inherit it."
So this is the land that he is going to inherit. This is the land that's promised to you. This is something that you can actually physically put your hand on. You can't put your hand on heaven. Nobody even has an idea of what it looks like. They think they have wings with human body and wings on them and so forth. So if you can't put your hand on it, you can't really call it. So another thing I want to say about that too, if you are in heaven at death, then Lazarus was pretty upset when Jesus rose him back from the dead 4 days after being dead. If he was already in paradise, if you will, then if you bring me back and I got to die again, something is wrong with that picture. I would have been upset. So our promise is, or the contract that we have is that if we obey what the Lord says, then he will in turn give us this inheritance, which is this land, which is Jerusalem. Okay? All right, let's go ahead and move on to Genesis. You still at 15? Where you at now?
18?
Skip down to 18. Go ahead.
In the same day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, "Unto thy seed have I given this land, from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates."
So you can put your finger on that. So you know what the promises is. Right. All right? Skip down to, let's move on to Genesis 17. We're going to pick this up at verse 1. Go ahead.
And when Abram was 90 years old and nine, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, "I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect."
Just basically do what I say. Go ahead.
"I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly." And Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, "As for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations."
Go ahead.
"Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham. For a father of many nations have I made thee."
Go ahead.
"And I will make thee exceeding fruitful, and I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee."
Go ahead.
"And I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed after thee, in their generations for an everlasting covenant.
Go ahead.
To be a God unto thee and to thy seed after thee.
Okay. Did you finish that? Go to verse 7 real quick.
Just finish verse 7. Verse 8.
Okay.
And I will give unto thee and to thy seed after thee the land wherein thou art a stranger,
mm-hmm.
all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God.
So he's saying he's giving you this land, all the land of Canaan, for a possession. He will be your God, and you will be his member, or you'll be a citizen in his faith, basically. All right, so let's talk about the things that are going to happen as a result of this. We have the agreement. Abraham is the father of the agreement. And now let's see how it comes into play. Let's go back here to Acts, the 7th chapter, and we're going to pick this up at verse 6. Acts 7 and verse 6. Go ahead.
And God spake on this wise,
mm-hmm.
that his seed should sojourn in a strange land, and that they should bring them into bondage,
mm-hmm.
and entreat them evil 400 years.
So we know that what happened, that's how the pyramids came into play. We built those. Go ahead.
And the nation to whom they shall be in bondage will I judge, mm-hmm. said God. And after that shall they come forth and serve me in this place.
Mm-hmm.
And he gave him the covenant of circumcision.
Mm-hmm.
And so Abraham begat Isaac and circumcised him the eighth day.
Mm-hmm.
And Isaac begat Jacob. And Jacob begat the 12 patriarchs.
So we got the 12 patriarchs here. 12 men, I should say, because sometimes people jump to 13 when they conclude Diana. We don't want to make that mistake. We want to make sure we understand it as 12. So this is the flow of the promise from Abraham, Isaac, to Jacob. All right? So we had the situation. Now we're going to look at what Abraham is actually going to observe, what is going to happen to the children of the covenant. Let's go here real quickly to Genesis, the 15th chapter. And I'm pretty sure some of you realize that there's a contract with the Lord that says if you do thus and such, he will bless you. And if you do thus and such, he will curse you. So there's a choice in this matter that you have. And hopefully we choose wisely. But again, I know that there's so much deception out there. And I was under deception for a long time before I came into the truth. So people are out there and they have really no clue what this doctrine is about, because we just don't read things. We are a visual people. We rather see it and not read it and then try to understand it and work with it. But the Lord says, be not deceived by any man, which means all of you, all of us, are required to read this book for ourselves. You are not to be deceived by me or anyone else. You got this as your foundation to deliver your soul. All right? All right, we're going to pick this up at Genesis, the 15th chapter. And we're going to pick it up at verse 12, 15 and 12. Go ahead.
And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram.
Uh-huh.
And lo, in horror of great darkness fell upon him.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs,
mm-hmm.
and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years.
Go ahead.
And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge. And afterwards shall they come out with great substance.
Mm-hmm.
And thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace. Thou shalt be buried in a good old age.
Okay. All right. Go ahead.
What was it?
That was 13? Okay. All right. So we know that that's the promise. We know that we're going to go into bondage. We're going to go into captivity. But we still have to understand how we follow this promise. So let's go to Hosea real quick. Hosea, the 12th chapter. And we're going to pick this up at verse 3. Hosea 12 and verse 3. And this is talking about Jacob. Hosea 12 and verse 3. Go ahead.
He took his brother by the heel in the womb.
That's Jacob taking the heel of his brother Esau. Go ahead.
And by his strength, he had power with God.
So by his strength, he had power with God, because the promises have already been established by Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Here's the carrying on of that. Go ahead.
Yeah. He had power over the angel and prevailed.
Mm-hmm.
He wept and made supplication unto him. He found him in Bethel, and there he spake with us.
Mm-hmm.
Even the Lord God of hosts, the Lord is his memorial.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, turn thou to thy God, Keep mercy and judgment and wait on thy God continually.
So wait on this God continually. And the question always is, you know, if I ask everybody here, or a lot of people here, particularly Israelites, if I ask you what must one do in order to be saved, most of us get into the legalities, keep the law, be baptized, etc. But if I go to a false prophet church, the first thing they would say is believe on Jesus Christ. So yes, that is the case. But which Christ do you believe on? Is yours born on the 25th day of December? Mine, I don't know. Did he say keep the first day of the week? Mine says keep the seventh day. So there's a big difference between the God that they serve, and they call his name Jesus, and there's a big difference between the one that we can read about in this book. So we need to make sure that we believe on the one that's in this book. All right, so let's observe real quickly how Jacob got his name. Let's go to Genesis, the 32nd chapter. Genesis 32. And we're going to pick this up at verse 1. Genesis 32 and verse 1. Go ahead.
And Jacob went on his way, and the angels of God met him. And when Jacob saw them, he said, this is God's host.
Mm-hmm.
And he called the name of that place Mahanaim.
Okay, skip down to verse 24.
And Jacob was left alone, and there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day.
Uh-huh.
And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh.
Mm-hmm.
And the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him.
Go ahead.
And he said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And he said, I will not let thee go, except thou bless me.
Go ahead.
And he said unto him, what is thy name? And he said, Jacob.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince has thou power with God, mm-hmm, and with men, and has prevailed.
So now this is the adoption. This is where the name Israel comes into play. Jacob, who is the father, or is Israel, and the children, the 12 tribes, the 12 patriarchs, are the remnant of the promise given unto Abraham. All right, let's move on to Psalms, the 78th chapter. And we're going to pick this up at verse 5. And this is where our role comes into place. Psalm 78 and verse 5. Go ahead.
For he established a testimony in Jacob,
uh-huh,
and appointed a law in Israel,
mm-hmm,
which he commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children.
So this is something that needs to be passed on to the next generation and every other generation that comes up. And every time a child is born to a male, or to a male and a female, that is a new generation. Go ahead.
That the generation to come might know them,
mm-hmm,
even the children which should be born,
mm-hmm,
who should arise and declare them to their children.
Go ahead.
That they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments.
So he wants you to keep his commandments. This is the protocol. This is the agreement that we have. All right. We're going to clarify this. Let's go to Acts, the 7th chapter. And I did mention to keep a mark in there, Acts 7. And we're going to pick this up at verse 30. Go ahead.
And when 40 years were expired,
mm-hmm,
there appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai an angel of the Lord,
mm-hmm,
in a flame of fire in a bush.
Okay.
When Moses saw it, he wondered at the sight. And as he drew near to behold it, the voice of the Lord came unto him.
Go ahead.
Saying, I am the God of thy fathers, the God of Abraham,
mm-hmm,
and the God of Isaac,
mm-hmm,
and the God of Jacob.
Mm-hmm.
Then Moses trembled and durst not behold. Then said the Lord to him, put off thy shoes from thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy ground.
Go ahead.
I have seen the affliction of my people, mm-hmm, which is in Egypt,
mm-hmm,
and I have heard their groaning, and have come down to deliver them.
Mm-hmm.
And now come, I will send thee into Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
This Moses, whom they refused, saying, who made thee a ruler and a judge? The same did God send to be a ruler and deliverer by the hand of the angel, which appeared to him in the bush.
Mm-hmm.
He brought them out After that, he had showed wonders and signs in the land of Egypt, and in the Red Sea, and in the wilderness 40 years. This is that Moses, which said unto the children of Israel, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren, like unto me. Him shall ye hear.
So he's talking not about himself. He's talking about Jesus.
That's right.
That is who you need to hear. But he's also pointing out here, too, that this one Moses that you refused, the one that everybody was trying to kill when he slayed the other Egyptian, this is the one that's going to be a ruler and a judge over you, led by the Father. All right, I think we couldn't cover that. So we know that this is the Lord coming. We know that he's going to use Moses to pass forth his information. So at this point in time, Moses is the intercessor. Moses is the one that communicates with the Lord. And we're going to see later on that after Jesus was sacrificed and raised from the dead, then a new intercessor came into play, replacing the old Aaron or the old priesthood, the Levitical priesthood, and now being under a new priesthood. And that is the priesthood of the Lord. So he is your intercessor now, making supplications to the Father for you while we're here on earth and he's there with him. All right? So let's move on real quickly here. One other thing I want to point out there that we... did you get to, how far did you go?
38.
Okay, 38. So another point that was made here is this was the church in the wilderness. So if you have a church in the wilderness, this is not a foundation, this is not a building, it is the people that make up the church. So when they say the church anniversary or the church building or whatever, it is not talking about a building here. We are talking about people because that is what makes up a church, all right? Okay, let's move on. Let's go on to Exodus, the 19th chapter. And in this Exodus 19, this is when the Lord actually came down and spoke to Israel. And he came with a loud thundering with the horns and everything and with a great smoke of fire on top of the mountain that it actually scared the children of Israel. So they said, hey, Moses, you go up there, you talk to him, at least we die. Otherwise, we don't want to deal with this guy because he's pretty serious to deal with. But go ahead. We're going to pick this up at Exodus 19 and verse 1. Go ahead.
In the third month, when the children of Israel were gone forth out of the land of Egypt, the same day came they into the wilderness of Sinai. For they were departed from Rephidim and were come to the desert of Sinai, and had pitched in the wilderness. And there Israel camped before the mount.
Go ahead.
And Moses went up unto God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, thus shalt thou say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel.
Hold on. We want to make sure we clarify this, that this is the Lord that's talking to Moses, and Moses is transferring this information to Moses, and Moses is going to inform the rest of the children of Israel. Go ahead.
Ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings, and brought you unto myself. Now, therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people.
Go ahead.
For all the earth is mine, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel.
So he's basically letting you know, out of your seeds, Jacob, out of your ancestors, came the priest and the prophets, the ones that were going to spread his word. He chose your nation to do this job. No other nation did he have this agreement with. So we just want to point that out. Did you finish that?
Yep.
Okay. So real quickly, I just want to make sure that we cover this. let's just skip down to verse 18. Don't turn just yet. Let's skip down to verse 18. Actually, I want to go to 16. Sorry. We'll pick up 16. Exodus 19 and 16. Go ahead.
And it came to pass on the third day, in the morning, that there were thunders and lightning, and a thick cloud upon the mount, and the voice of the trumpet exceeding loud, so that all the people that was in the camp trembled.
So they were scared. Go ahead.
And Moses brought forth the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the nether part of the mount. And Mount Sinai was altogether on a smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire. And the smoke thereof ascended as the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mount quaked greatly.
Go ahead.
And when the voice of the trumpet sounded long and waxed louder and louder, Moses spake, and God answered him by a voice. And the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai on the top of the mount, and the Lord called Moses up to the top of the mount, and Moses went up.
So This is the way he came down the mountain, and just know for a fact that he came down in a smoke and a similitude, no image whatsoever, because he knew that Israel would definitely start creating images. And unfortunately, in today's society, this is why so much confusion out there is because we do have an image. We have a Gentile with hippie-like hair, with a beard, and that is our image of what Jesus looks like. And there is no reference to that whatsoever. So this is why, you know, I think for us in particular, our children are the ones filling up the prison houses because we're giving them a false doctrine. They are confused. They think they have a blue-eyed Jesus, but the same one that looks like Jesus is the same one that's putting us in prison houses, sticking us in, jail, you name it. It's just all the curses come upon you because of this confusion. And that's because we didn't do this thing right. That's the main thing I want to point out there. All right, we're going to move on here. Let's go to, we know that Israel is supposed to be the kingdom of priests and a holy nation. So let's go to Romans 3, and we're going to pick this up at verse 1. Romans 3, and this is what makes us different from a lot of the other religions that are out there. Romans 3, and we're going to pick this up at verse 1. Go ahead.
What advantage then have the Jew? Mm-hmm. Or what profit is there of circumcision?
So what profit is it to be one of us? What does it mean? Go ahead.
Much every way, chiefly, because that unto them were committed the oracles of God.
So the oracles of God, the answers from God, this is the thing that you bring to the table when there is a discussion about this God. But if you don't have it, you just don't have it. But we do have it, and we know we have it, and this is our responsibility. And the ones that are doing it otherwise are teaching a Gentile doctrine or a doctrine of paganism, if you will, with something that cannot be supported. And I read it just recently in a Catholic article. It says Sunday has never been, there is not one reference in this entire Bible that sanctifies Sunday as a holy day, but yet their doctrine teaches it. And it's all acceptable. If it's not broken, don't fix it. If it's bringing in, if it's doing the job that you want it to do. All right, did you finish that?
Yep.
Okay. We're going to move on to Romans, the 19th chapter. I mean, 9th chapter. And this is the adoption. The 9th chapter and verse 1. Go ahead.
I say the truth in Christ. Mm-hmm. I lie not. Mm-hmm. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost.
Go ahead.
That I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart.
And this is a sad thing because we do have it. I have it especially for everybody tomorrow. All those people, I just see the walking dead. Today they're doing funerals in their churches. They have no idea that having a dead body in your church makes that whole place unclean. And then they're gonna all group together tomorrow as though it didn't even happen. So the Lord is telling us, you know, he's showing us things that you do not come close to things like that. It is unhealthy, it is unclean, so don't do it. But that's what our leadership is doing. They're doing just the opposite of what the Lord has put in place. Go ahead.
3. For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, mm-hmm. my kinsmen according to the flesh.
According to the flesh, go ahead.
Who are Israelites, mm-hmm. to whom pertaineth the adoption.
The adoption, go ahead.
And the glory.
Uh-huh.
And the covenant.
Uh-huh.
And the giving of the law.
And the giving of the law. And tomorrow they're not going to even talk about the law. Go ahead.
And the service of God.
Uh-huh.
And the promises.
So we have the services of God and the promises of God. This is what we have. This is what gives us the understanding over all the other nations. This is why we have an advantage, because we don't think that when you die, you go to heaven. We know that we got to do this thing right. You got to be good. You got to treat everyone else like you would treat yourself. You can't say you're a Christian and then your actions speak totally different. You can't say you're a Christian and you're dropping pork and catfish all day and night. You can't say you're a Christian if you're doing the first day of the week, Christmas, Easter, and all those other pagan days, but yet you are still a Christian. Those things don't add up, and that is what gives us the answers from God, letting us know that is the wrong way to go. So that's a blessing in itself. I believe you finished that, right?
5.
Go ahead.
Whose are the fathers, and of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came,
mm-hmm.
who was over all, God blessed forever. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Not as though the word of God have taken none effect,
mm-hmm.
for they are not all Israel, which are of Israel.
Go ahead.
Neither, because they are the seed of Abraham, are they all children. But in Isaac shall thy seed be called.
Okay, so we know that it went from Abraham to Isaac, and from Isaac to Jacob. That is the protocol of the promise. I believe you finished that, right? Yeah. All right, let's back it up a little bit. We're going to go to Romans, the third chapter.
No, we already did.
We did that? Amos, I'm sorry. Amos 2. All right, we're going to Amos, the second chapter. And we're going to pick this up at verse 10. Go ahead.
Also, I brought you up from the land of Egypt and led you 40 years through the wilderness to possess the land of the Amorites.
Go ahead.
And I raised up of your sons for prophets.
So he used our sons or used our relatives as prophets. Go ahead.
And of your young men for Nazarites.
For Nazarites. Go ahead.
Is it not even thus, O ye children of Israel, saith the Lord?
Go ahead.
But ye gave the Nazarites wine to drink and commanded the prophets, saying, prophesy not.
So this is Israel. No surprise, people, because after all those things that the Lord did in Egypt, soon as they crossed the Red Sea on dry land, get to the other side, Moses gone for a few days, approximately 40 days, and they had already built a golden calf saying, these be your gods, Israel. These are your ancestors. And it's a sad thing. I'm getting to the point now where I don't even ask why anymore, because things are just so unusual. Why even ask that question? So let's move on here. But we see that they are set up from our flesh and through our generations, right? Let's pick it up one more time in that same regard in Psalms, the 147th chapter. And we're going to pick this up at verse 19. Psalms 147 and verse 19. Go ahead.
He showeth his word unto Jacob,
His
statutes and his judgments unto Israel.
So he's showing you these things. He's giving it unto Jacob. Go ahead.
He hath not dealt so with any nation.
Uh-huh.
And as for his judgments, they have not known them.
So he has not dealt with any other nation. As far as his judgments, the dietary law, the law of killing or the law of marriage, all of those things, they didn't have that. Only we had that, and we got that from the Lord, and we mistreated it, we did not appreciate it, and that is the reason why we are in the situation we are in today. It's a perfect curse that he did to us. I mean, you can't give the Gentile credit for this perfect destruction of this nation of people. This is just too good. It's too perfect. You drive through our neighborhoods, it's so vacant. You try to get a job. If your name is Shaquika, it's going to be pretty hard to do that. But we still name our children these things. You understand what I'm saying? You cannot see all the things that you are doing out here, but they are because you are under the curses that you are doing this. You know, it's no sense in having a bad situation, but then when you open your mouth or you make a statement, you make the situation worse. Israel is good for doing that. We could have the prize in our hand and we're still going to say something, so they're going to just take it back or give it to somebody else. This is just our people. That's why I don't ask why anymore. All right, let's go and move over to Matthew, the 15th chapter. Matthew 15. And we're going to pick this up at verse 21. Matthew 15 and verse 21. Go ahead.
Then Jesus went thence and departed into the coasts of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil.
Go ahead.
But he answered her not a word.
Mm-hmm.
And his disciples came and besought him, saying, Send her away, for she crieth after us.
Go ahead.
But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Isn't that something? He was only sent to us. Couldn't be shared with anybody else. And with us, even when he was here, we didn't appreciate him. We didn't show him no faith. It's some talent we had, or something we had, or Abraham had, or that Noah had, that he chose us, but he missed an ingredient there somewhere. But then, too, he called the end from the beginning, so he may just be sitting back watching the movie, just like you'd be watching part one and part two. Now, by understanding the feast days, all seven feast days, we understand the master plan. And if you don't keep all of his Sabbath or all of his feast days, then there's no way you could understand the master plan. So that again is another oracle that you have, or a revelations, or an answer from God on what you need to do and how to operate. All right, I believe we finished that, right?
Yep.
Okay, moving right along here. Let's move to John, the fourth chapter. And we're gonna pick this up at verse 19. John 4 and 19. Go ahead.
The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet.
Mm-hmm.
Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship.
So he's letting her know. Go ahead.
Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh, mm-hmm. when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father.
Go ahead.
Ye worship, ye know not what.
Uh-huh.
We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews.
So we know we're working for the promised land. We're not trying to get to heaven. We're not trying to get to paradise. We have the correct roadmap, or the correct schedule, if you will, based upon the words of this book. Go ahead.
But the hour coming,
mm-hmm.
and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth.
Mm-hmm.
For the Father seeketh such to worship him.
Ooh, go ahead.
God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
So this is what he's telling you. You have to worship him in spirit and in truth. Who's truth? His truth. Not man's truth,
that's right,
but his truth. All right, we're going to clarify this even more. Let's go over to Acts, the first chapter. I'm sorry, we're going to go to Romans, the first chapter. I didn't know I was hitting Romans so much today, but we're really in there. All right. Romans 1, and we're going to pick this up at verse 13. Go ahead.
Now I will not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you, but was let hitherto,
mm-hmm.
that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles.
Go ahead.
I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise.
Go ahead.
So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also.
Mm-hmm.
For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek.
So to anyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. So, again, that is the advantage of having the oracles or being chosen by this God. And, again, this is Black History Month. Just want all y'all to know this is true Black history. This is not American Black history. Okay? All right, let's move right along. Let's go to Acts, the first chapter. Am I going to Matthew 10? We're going to do Matthew 10. Matthew 10 and verse 5. Go ahead.
These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying,
mm-hmm.
Go not into the way of the Gentiles,
mm-hmm.
and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not.
Mm-hmm.
But go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And as ye go, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
Okay. All right. So he's basically letting you know. He was not sent to the Gentiles, nor were our disciples, the apostles, sent to the Gentiles. It was to the Jew first, and then to the Gentile. And if Israel rejected the prophet or that preacher, then lo, they turn to the Gentiles. You got to go with where there's fruit. And if there's no way to harvest any fruit from a certain location, you move to the next location.
Right.
If you can't reap anything there, you keep moving. And believe me, we reap a neighborhood. We can reap a neighborhood. We can reap a field. There's nothing after we come through it. Believe me. So that is that. All right, we're going to move on to Acts.
Verse 8.
Okay, go ahead and finish that.
Heal the sick. Cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely ye have received, freely give.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's basically the purpose behind our ministry. do what you're supposed to do. All right? Let's go ahead and move on to Acts, the first chapter. And we're going to pick this up at verse 1. Acts 1 and verse 1. Go ahead.
The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach.
Go ahead.
Until the day in which he was taken up, after that he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen.
Keep going.
To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs.
So this was not, or Passover was not his last supper. Go ahead.
Being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me.
Go ahead.
For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence.
Go ahead.
When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel?
Good question. Go ahead.
And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons, which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth.
Go ahead. All right, great. So he's letting you know that the Holy Ghost is going to be communicated to you. That's when you are baptized and the Holy Ghost will come upon you. In this case here, the apostles had to go to Jerusalem or stay in Jerusalem until the Holy Ghost was sent to them. But first the Lord had to be presented himself before he sent the Holy Ghost or the Comforter unto the apostles. All right, so we see that that's the case here. All right, let's move on to Acts, the second chapter. And we're going to pick this up at verse 1. Go ahead.
And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance.
Go ahead.
And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven.
So here, they were all Jews, devout men that were at Pentecost, not Gentiles. This is a perfect proof of that, out of every nation. And then you can see here that they all spoke different languages. And one thing I like to reflect back on too, is that when I think about Israel, the 12 tribes, and what they did when they were in the wilderness, what they the Lord was with them for those 40 years, then after that, they ended up having David as their leader, taking them through all the different locations and so forth, delivering them. They had one person as a leader, but they had 12 different gangs. You understand what I'm saying? All of them, it was in a gang at this point. And they were able to get along. Why? Because they all had the same purpose or were on the same agenda. We can't get on no one agenda. I mean, I'm talking blocks, city blocks. We can't do that. But there's a possibility that we could if we could all be on that same mindset, or if we all read this book as it is written, rather than putting our own interpretations into play. Right. And I like the fact that I could call the game because it gives us a reference of how severe this can be. I mean, everybody's going to be loyal to their family, going to be loyal to their gang or what have you. But then you all are going to submit yourself to that one powerful one because you know that there is a higher being. We pretend like that don't even exist today. This is a life for a life, a dollar for a dollar. Make it the best way you can. So that's one thing I just want to point out there. Did we finish that?
Verse 6.
Go ahead.
Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans?
Don't they all speak shouldn't they be speaking Galileans? How do I understand them in my own language? So this was the cloven tongues that did all the translations for everybody could understand. This was the day of Pentecost. This was 49 days after after Passover. So it took them this long to figure out that they had killed the Messiah. And at this point in Acts 2, y'all know at verse 36, it just tells him, he said, being a brother, what shall we do? And that's when Peter tells him, repent and be baptized, right, because y'all didn't kill the Messiah. And again, they had not figured that out until all that time, what they had done. All right, we finished that, correct?
8.
Oh, gosh, man, go ahead.
And how hear we every man in our own tongue, mm-hmm, wherein we were born?
Okay.
Parthians and Medes and Elamites and the dwellers in Mesopotamia and in Judea and in Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia, Pergia and Pamphylia and Egypt and in the parts of Libya about Cyrene, mm-hmm, and strangers of Rome, mm-hmm, Jews and proselytes.
Okay, hold on. We can stop there. I want to skip down a little bit. Let's skip down to verse 14.
But Peter, mm-hmm, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, mm-hmm, ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words.
Skip down to verse 22.
Ye men of Israel, mm-hmm, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles, mm-hmm, and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know.
Again, also to Israel. Skip down to verse 36.
Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly, mm-hmm, that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ.
So I always tell people, be careful how you treat the water boy or how you treat that lowest person in that situation, because that could be your boss sometime soon. And that's what basically is happening here. They thought they had gotten rid of Jesus by killing him. And unfortunately, he turned out to be the main one in charge. How bad can that be for repercussions? You know what I'm saying? So, all right, keep going.
37. Mm-hmm. Now, when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, mm-hmm, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do?
What shall we do after we kill the Messiah? What? Go ahead.
Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ.
No, wait a minute. It should be the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, right?
Nope.
He didn't say use the title?
Nope.
He said Jesus, right?
Right.
Okay, and Jesus is what? The Father, Son, and he can control the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
So get away from titles and get to the name that you really need to be dealing with. Go ahead.
In the name of Jesus Christ, mm-hmm, for the remission of sins, mm-hmm, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
So he's still going to have mercy on you. You still got a chance to repent, because you can be baptized and move forward and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. All right. I believe you got verse 39 to go?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
For the promise is unto you and to your children, mm-hmm, and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call.
So the promise is unto you. It's up to you to decide to go for this promise. Are you wanting to be a part of this promise? Are you wanting to be a part of this covenant? This is the choice you have to make. You can go to church tomorrow if you want to. But who would you be serving? Obviously not the God of this Bible. All right, let's move on here. We finished that. Let's go to Acts, the 7th chapter. And again, we're back to stepping here. We got to pick it up at verse 39. Acts 7. And 39. Go ahead.
To whom our fathers would not obey, mm-hmm, but thrust him from them, and in their hearts turned back again into Egypt.
Go ahead.
Saying unto Aaron, make us gods to go before us. Uh-huh. For as for this Moses, which brought us out of the land of Egypt, we will not what has become of him.
Quick and easy, making a decision to make a move just because somebody disappeared for a minute. Go ahead.
And they made a calf in those days, mm-hmm, and offered sacrifice unto the idol, and rejoiced in the works of their own hands. Mm. Then God turned and gave them up to worship the host of heaven, mm-hmm, as it is written in the book of the prophets. O ye house of Israel, have ye offered to me slain beasts and sacrifices by the space of 40 years in the wilderness?
Go ahead.
Yea. Ye took up the tabernacle of Moloch, mm-hmm, and the star of your god Remphan, mm-hmm, figures which ye made to worship them, mm-hmm, and I will carry you away beyond Babylon.
So the Lord sounds like he's upset here. And again, I mean, you do all these things for this people, and there is no appreciation. Betrayal is probably one of the worst things you can do to, yep, someone that hurt their feelings. Go ahead.
That was it.
That was it? You finished that? That was at 43?
Yeah, that was 43.
Okay. All right, great. We're going to move on to Exodus, the 31st chapter. And the reason I like to bring this up is because I like to show that there is an identification factor of those that do serve this God. And the reason they do is because of fear, because there is some repercussions to how you do service. So I just want to make sure everybody's understanding of this, because when we talk about the days, we talk about the Sabbaths, not just the seventh day. We talk about all the Sabbath days. Exodus 31, and we're going to pick this up at verse 12. Exodus 31 and verse 12. Go ahead.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying.
Okay, this is the Lord talking again, not Moses. Go ahead.
Speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily my Sabbaths ye shall keep.
So you see it is an S on the end of that. It's not just the one Sabbath, the weekly Sabbath. So you can't just be a seven-day Adventist or a one-week keeper or seven-day keeper. You have to do all of his Sabbath days. Go ahead.
For it is a sign between me and you.
So it is a sign that shows that we are with him. And if I see that you're doing what he asked you to do, then I know you probably an Israelite or you got some understanding. And if you know, if you're doing something contrary, I know, and you say you're a Christian, I know what kind of Christian you are right away.
That's right.
So it is a sign that we can use to identify one another. Go ahead.
Throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you.
Okay, so you are sanctified. You are set apart. Look at, we may look like we're small here, but tomorrow it's going to be huge chairs filled up, parking spaces taken to do what? Learn nothing. And to waste your time serving some unknown God who you do not know. I mean, it's that simple. It's basically the dead with the dead. I understand what he said when he said, let the dead bury the dead. Ain't nothing you can do to some for some of them because they are going to be caught up in what they're doing anyway. Go ahead.
14. You shall keep the Sabbath, therefore, for it is holy unto you. Everyone that defileth it shall surely be put to death.
What's the consequences? Death. Go ahead.
For whosoever doeth any work therein, that soul shall be cut off from among his people.
Okay, so does the Lord owe an apology to the man that was picking up sticks on the Sabbath day? Does he owe an apology to anybody that goes out and work tomorrow? Not by choice. I'm going to say today, but not if you have to do it, you have to. But if you can get around it, or if you have a choice to get around it, my recommendation is that you do that. Don't do it if you have a choice. Go ahead.
15. 6 days may work be done, but in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest, holy to the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death.
Now, we know for a fact, in the very beginning, in Genesis 1, we know that the Lord gave he gave no name to all the 6 days before that. He said the first day, the second day, the third, all the way to the sixth. But this day, the seventh day, he named that day, set it apart, sanctified it, and blessed it. He didn't bless the first day.
Nope.
And again, I just hate to keep going back to it. Why do they do it? It's just like totally contrary. And that's the way Satan operates. He is totally contrary to the word of God. And to be in that thing and not know it is a like a double whammy. You know what I mean? You think you're doing the right thing, but in all essence, you are wasting your time. All right, go ahead.
16. Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant.
A perpetual covenant? That's a permanent covenant. That's something we have to do forever. Go ahead.
It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever.
Uh-huh.
For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed.
Okay, so we know that 1,000 years is 1 day to the Lord, so our time element is totally different from man. A lot of people believe that those 7 days are literally 7 days that he did the creation, but they lack the understanding that a new Sabbath day is coming. And we're going to touch on that, and I'm going to show you that in a minute here. But the main thing I want you to understand is the Lord hands out talents to everybody. And in this case here, these are talents that you are given. And it would be my advice that you do the best you can for him, because he's going to ask you that question, or somebody's going to ask you that question. What have you done for the Lord lately? So hopefully you have an answer to that question. Because if you don't, if the Lord don't need you now, he's not going to need you then. So if you're no good here on earth, what good you going to be to him then? So make use of your talents, people. We're going to touch on that. We're going to go to Matthew, the 25th chapter, and we're going to pick this up at verse 14. Matthew 14, 25 and 14. Go ahead.
For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country.
Travailing.
traveling or traveling? Traveling into a far country.
Okay.
Who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods.
Mm-hmm.
And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2,
mm-hmm.
and to another 1. To every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey.
Go ahead.
Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same,
mm-hmm.
and made them other 5 talents.
Go ahead.
And likewise, he that had received 2, he also gained other 2.
Go ahead.
But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money.
Mm-hmm.
After a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them.
Mm-hmm.
And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more.
Go ahead.
His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things.
Go ahead.
Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord.
Go ahead.
He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them.
Go ahead.
His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things.
Mm-hmm.
I will make thee ruler over many things.
The reward. Go ahead.
Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown,
mm-hmm.
and gathering where thou hast not straw.
Mm-hmm.
And I was afraid, and went and hid thy talent in the earth.
Mm-hmm.
Lo, there thou hast that is thine.
Mm-hmm.
His Lord answered and said unto him, thou wicked and slothful servant,
mm-hmm.
thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not, and gather where I have not straw.
Mm-hmm.
Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at the coming I should have received my own with usury.
Mm-hmm.
Take therefore the talent from him, and give it unto him which hath 10 talents.
Mm-hmm.
For unto every one that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that have not shall be taken away even that which he hath.
Mm-hmm.
And cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
So not only do you receive this grace or this understanding, you have to do something with it. You cannot have no reward for the Lord for him bringing you into this thing. So there is a contract here. There's a reason why you are giving the level of understanding you have and giving the capacity to do the work that you can do. And if you have the ability, people, please do the best you can, because you would hate for me to be the one on top of you on judgment day and saying, hey, I know I told you. I know I gave you the message. So that said, do the best you can. Let's move right forward to 2 Timothy and take a look at this. 2 Timothy 2, and we're going to pick this up at verse 19. 2 Timothy 2 and 19. Go ahead.
Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure,
mm-hmm.
having this seal. The Lord know of them that are his,
mm-hmm.
and let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity.
Mm-hmm.
But in the great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver,
mm-hmm.
but also of wood and of earth,
mm-hmm.
and some to honor and some to dishonor.
Go ahead.
If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor,
mm-hmm.
sanctified, and meet for the master's use.
So what he's basically saying here is that don't put your hope in money. Put your trust in your spirit, or use your spiritual trust and use that talent. Go ahead.
And prepare unto every good work.
Mm-hmm.
Flee also youthful lust, but follow righteousness,
mm-hmm.
faith, charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart.
Mm-hmm.
But foolish and unlearned questions avoid,
mm-hmm.
knowing that they do gender strifes.
Go ahead.
And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, and meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves.
Mm-hmm.
If God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil,
mm-hmm.
who are taken captive by him at his will.
At his will, which means if he see what you're doing and if he can operate He can definitely take advantage of it because he knows how to read you. Mm-hmm. Money, lust, sin, all those things. If those are the things you desire, then he will have no problem recruiting you. Hmm. You finished that, correct? Yep. All right, let's move to 2 Timothy, the third chapter. And you should just turn right over. Go right ahead.
This know also, mm-hmm. that in the last days, perilous times shall come.
And we are in perilous times. January 20th created a perilous time. We don't know what's going to happen after this Donald Trump, but go ahead.
For men shall be lovers of their own selves, mm-hmm. covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, mm-hmm. disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, mm-hmm. without natural affection, truce breakers, mm-hmm. false accusers, mm-hmm. incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, mm-hmm. traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, mm-hmm. having a form of godliness, mm-hmm. but denying the power thereof. Mm-hmm. From such, turn away.
So he's telling you, come out of her. Come out of that mother. Come out of Catholicism. That's basically what it is. It's the universal religion. You can call it whatever you want. You can call whatever you do yours, Baptist, Pentecostal, whatever. But if you're doing first day of the week, that came from Rome. You're doing Easter, that came from Rome. You're doing Christmas, that came from Rome. So you got to be careful who you're serving. We finished that, correct?
Six.
So go ahead.
For of this sort are they which creep into houses, mm-hmm. and lead captive silly women laden with sins, mm. led away with diverse lusts, mm. ever learning, and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now, I'm sorry, but...
No, I'm coming. Wait till you finish that.
Now, as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Mm-hmm. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. Mm-hmm. But they shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs also was. Mm-hmm. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, mm-hmm. manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions which came unto me at Antioch, mm-hmm. at Iconium, at Lystra, mm-hmm. what persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Mm-hmm. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution.
So you're going to suffer persecution. You're going to deal with the high-mindedness of people being proud. Mm-hmm. If you're going in talking your religion and putting theirs down, you're going to get talked about. You might get fired.
Thank
you. You know? That's why I tell people, don't bring this up on your job, because you can hurt some people. You have to look at the consequences that come about of you saying, hey, your God ain't no God. That starts wars, people.
Yep.
It truly starts wars. So be careful how you handle that situation.
Yep.
All right, we're going to move on to
13.
You had 13?
Yeah.
All right, go ahead.
But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, mm-hmm. deceiving and being deceived.
Mm-hmm.
But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, mm-hmm. knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures,
mm-hmm.
which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus.
So what is going to make you wise? The holy scriptures.
That's right.
Not what I say. Not what any man says,
right.
but these scriptures are going to deliver you. This is your roadmap to salvation. Go ahead.
All scripture is given by inspiration of God,
mm-hmm.
and is profitable for doctrine,
mm-hmm.
for reproof,
mm-hmm.
for correction.
Whoa, for reproof and correction?
Mm-hmm.
At the right place and time is what I would say. Go ahead.
For instruction in righteousness,
mm-hmm.
that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works.
Great. Okay. So we understand that we have to be accountable. That's what this means here. You have to be accountable for your actions, because you are going to be judged by every idle word you say, by every action that you do. I continuously ask the Lord to forgive me. I go back way to things that happened a long time ago. I'm trying to get those things straight or try to repent for it, because I may have just thought upon it in some reason or another. But I ask for forgiveness at all times, and I ask to repent at all times. So keep those things in mind. All right, let's move on now to, did you finish that?
Yep.
Okay, Ecclesiastes.
We're going to,
say what now?
Timothy 4.
Oh, all right, move on, Timothy 4:1. Okay, go ahead.
I charge thee therefore before God,
mm-hmm.
and the Lord Jesus Christ,
mm-hmm.
who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom.
Go ahead.
Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine.
Whoa, they can't endure it now. Hmm. We know they can't. And we all of y'all have arguments with these people. We still have some open chairs in here. This place should be blasting or busting out with people trying to get salvation. Mm-hmm. But it ain't happening. And that's because they are in a blind sleep. Go ahead.
But after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears.
Mm-hmm.
And they shall turn away their ears from the truth,
mm-hmm,
and shall be turned unto fables.
So they're turning unto fables. They don't want to hear the truth. And we know what fables we're talking about. We're talking about Santa Claus going all the way around the world and delivering all these things. I mean, some things are a miracle in the Bible. I agree with that. And sometimes, you know, scientists try to come up with their reasons for that. But believe me, there is no Santa Claus. There is no Santa Claus, and there are no flying reindeers, and we didn't have a chimney, so I knew something was wrong with that thing from the very beginning. You know what I'm saying? So if you don't come through doors, I ain't got a chance, right? And if you don't know how to pick locks, you can't get in here. So that was a pretty touchy situation. So I knew that that wasn't happening. But the fables are out there. I mean, the Easter Bunny, he ain't got nothing to do with no with Jesus. In fact, bunnies don't even lay eggs. They give out alive babies. You get chicken eggs. So you're trying to tell me to pretend like this rabbit is laying eggs, but the chicken is the one that's doing it, but I'm supposed to be okey-doked and understand that that's the real deal here. And the bunny is around spreading the Easter egg, getting rid of the eggs, so you don't have to deal with the chicken no more. They taking his food, too. So, yeah, I wouldn't mind being the Easter bunny if I got to get rid of the chicken to get fed. But anyway, all right. Did you finish that, bro?
Verse 5.
Go ahead, man.
But watch thou in all things. Endure afflictions.
Mm-hmm.
Do the work of an evangelist.
Mm-hmm.
Make full proof of thy ministry.
So you have to be able to make full proof of your ministry. If you cannot read it, then you have to let it go.
That's right.
And if there's any lie in this book or anything contrary in this book, then I have to throw it away.
Mm-hmm.
I have to give it back and say, hey, we got a problem here, Lord. I can't deal with this, man, because I have to be accountable. And another thing that just amazes me, I mean, we're dealing with people that are scientists, engineers, doctors, lawyers, what do you call them, statisticians, and all this stuff. I mean, got great certificates. But if you ask them what day they go to church, they're going to say Sunday. And you're like, man, what did you do, just drop the ball? But people don't take this to be important because they think they have the option of just at the last minute, you get the final thing as they're dying, the priest come and give them the confession, and then they can go ahead and die, and then they'll make it into the kingdom. It just ain't happening. This is not happening. So there has to be a little accountability for the things that we do, and we have to realize that if you have a organization, no matter what your organization is, you're going to have some type of bylaws, you're going to have some kinds of rules of order, some type of organization. Otherwise, everything is chaotic. Why can't this God have some kind of organization? All you gotta do is believe. And believe me, if that was the case, man, that would be so cool. I would be free. I wouldn't even have to be here today. Because I believe that I'm gonna go to the kingdom.
Right.
So why waste my time in church? Why try to even learn this book?
Right.
If it's all that simple. I think if that was the case, I wouldn't even be bothered. But anyway, I think you finished that, right?
Yep.
Okay. So let's go to Ecclesiastes. The 12th chapter, Ecclesiastes 12, and we're going to pick this up at verse 8. Go ahead.
Vanity of vanities,
mm-hmm,
saith the preacher.
All this stuff out here is vanity. We look at things, I mean, you look at the women. I hate to say this, but the high heels, the lipstick, the arching of the eyebrows. I mean, we're doing it all. Breast implants, the back end implants.
The back end.
y'all gonna get mad at me for saying this, but I'm gonna go ahead and get it and say it. The female is the best imposter I ever seen. You know what I'm saying? You're not the same when we Friday evening or Tuesday evening. And then you wake up going out the door, you look like the queen of, the Sahara or whatever, right? I mean, it's totally different. And then when you're out there, you the world just looks beautiful. But when you remove everything, it's like, whoa. What happened? I'll be getting my things right now as I am leaving. With men, you get what you see, and that's it. That's it. I mean, you may get a decent haircut, that kind of thing. But some of them doing makeup too now, so I don't know what to say. Transgressions are almost near full. Y'all know that. And it's all vanity. It is all vanity.
Yep.
The thing I do push is that if a woman's going to get with a man, make sure the man's established.
Yep.
Make sure he has a driver's license, a job, getting ready to graduate or something. Because we know it's going to happen. As soon as y'all get together, as soon as we get together with any other of the opposite sex, bam, it just happened. And we know it happened because we feel the skies, the stars of the skies, the sand of the sea. We look at one another and have a baby or get pregnant. Y'all know that. So we just got to make more sense of the things we do. All right. We finish that?
End of verse 8.
Thank you, man.
All is vanity.
Vanity. Go ahead.
And moreover, because the preacher was wise, he still taught the people knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
Yay. He gave good heed and sought out and set in order many proverbs.
Mm-hmm.
The preacher sought to find out acceptable words, and that which was written was upright, even words of truth.
So we know that he was dealing with the book. He didn't just open it, read half of a scripture, have all the officers of the church stand up every time he touched a scripture, and then speak, I call it motivational speaking, for another hour and a half.
Yep.
And then you walk out the door, what did you learn today? Well, I think Sister So-and-so is kicking it with so-and-so over there. And I think that's what he was bringing out, because they was caught in the church basement the last week or something. It has nothing to do with education. It has nothing to do with knowledge. What they're getting is motivational speaking. And my company used to pay for us to go to those kind of affairs. And I'm thinking I'm going there to learn some business skills, sales skills, and whatnot. It was motivational speakers teaching religion. But that's what it's all about now. So they're going to make their money. And that's what the whole key is, entertainment, get you to drop money in the bucket rather than give you some understanding or to give you some knowledge on how to save your soul. Go ahead.
That's it.
Okay. All right, we're going to move on to Acts, the 19th chapter. And this is one that's key to me, because if you don't see these signs, then maybe you need to revisit what a pastor is, or what a minister is, what a deacon is, or what are the roles of the people that call themselves your spiritual leaders. Acts 19, and we're going to pick this up at verse 9. Go ahead.
But when divers were hardened and believed not, but spake evil of that way before the multitude, he departed from them and separated the disciples, dispute daily in the school of one Tyrannus. And this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all they which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks.
Go ahead.
And God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. Then certain of the vagabond Jews, exorcists, took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preached.
Isn't that something? They're using the third person, but they saying whoever Paul God is, that's the man.
That's the word.
And we adjure you as a result of Paul's God, because he said it.
Yep.
Go ahead.
And there were 7 sons of one Sceva, a Jew, and chief of the priests, which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus, I know, and Paul, I know, but who are ye?
So he's asking them, who are you? I know Paul. I know Jesus. Go ahead.
And the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them and overcame them and prevailed against them so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded.
So definitely you want to make sure your ministry is proved fully before you go out there trying to attack this devil, because you can run into the wrong situation. So make sure of that ministry. All right, let's move on here. Another thing you need to know is that the teacher should be sent. So in this industry, people are sent up in front of this pulpit, and for whatever reason it may be, it's because we are required to teach you the law and teach you how to save your soul. But on tomorrow, if I am not giving you proper direction, or I'm giving you deceptions, first day of the week, Christmas, Easter, your money is going to save souls, et cetera, then we know that preacher has not been sent. And if we have to interview our preacher for the position of pastor, then who is the leader? Is it the congregation, or is it the preacher that was sent? We have to think about that. Let's move on. Go ahead. We're going to go to John chapter 5. I guess y'all are already there, huh? See, yeah, okay. All right. John chapter 5. I get to do the talking, though. John chapter 5, we're going to pick this up at verse 39. Go ahead.
Search the scriptures, mm-hmm. for in them ye think ye have eternal life, mm-hmm. and they are they which testify of me.
So these are what testify of Jesus Christ. It says search the scriptures. And when he talks about scriptures, he's talking about the old and the new, not just the New Testament. So you cannot be just a New Testament Christian. Go ahead.
And ye will not come to me that ye might have life. Mm-hmm. I receive not honor from men, but I know you, that ye have not the love of God in you.
Go ahead.
I am come in my Father's name, mm-hmm. and ye receive me not. Mm-hmm. If another shall come in his own name, him ye will receive.
And you know what? Again, that's another thing of vanity. We look for the person that has driving a nice car or dressing well and things like that. We want to be their friend, but the one that can give us eternal salvation, we can dust him off because that ain't a priority at this point. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
How can ye believe, mm-hmm. which receive honor one of another, and seek not the honor that cometh from God only? Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father.
Whoa. He said, don't think I'm going to accuse you to the Father. Go ahead.
There's one that accuseth you, uh-huh. even Moses, in whom ye trust.
So Moses, who was supposed to be one of the most sincere men out there, his instructions to you is what you're going to be judged on. Not the New Testament, but what Moses wrote. What did Moses write? The commandments, mm-hmm. the judgments, the statutes. Those are all there. Go ahead.
For had ye believed Moses, mm-hmm. ye would have believed me, mm-hmm. for he wrote of me.
Whoa, so Moses wrote of him. And if you toss Moses aside, then you have basically taught your road to salvation right out the door. Go ahead.
But if ye believe not his writings, mm-hmm. how shall ye believe my word? Mm.
Go ahead.
That's it.
All right, so if you do not believe what he wrote, how are you going to believe that the Lord was the one that was speaking to Moses, telling him, say unto the children of Israel, thus and such and thus and such? So it's coming from the Lord. It's not coming from Moses. All right, we're going to move on real quick. We're going to confirm that. We're going to go to Luke, the 16th chapter, and we're going to pick this up at verse 24. Luke 16 and 24. Go ahead.
And he cried and said, Father, mm-hmm. Abraham, have mercy on me, mm-hmm. and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, mm-hmm. for I am tormented in this flame.
So this is the story of the rich man and Lazarus, the poor man or the beggar. The rich man is now looking upon Abraham, and he's seeing that Lazarus is comforted in with him, and he's asking that Lazarus dip his hand in some water and soothe him a little bit. But let's see what Abraham says here. Go ahead.
But Abraham said, mm-hmm. son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, mm-hmm. and likewise Lazarus evil things. Mm-hmm. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. Mm.
Go ahead.
And beside all this, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, mm-hmm. so that they which will pass from hence to you cannot, mm-hmm. neither can they pass to us that will come from thence.
So there's a great gap here where if you're in the lake of fire, you can actually look up and see the people that are in the kingdom. And this has not been set up yet, and I'm going to show you that. But the people in the kingdom can also look upon them that are tormenting in the fire and with wormwood to keep them straight. Otherwise, they be going into that place, right. and which you will actually be able to see. So when you're seeing something like that, you're going to do your best not to go to that place. Go ahead.
Then he said, I pray thee, therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. Uh-huh. For I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment.
So he's saying, man, send Lazarus over there. Surely if Lazarus go over there from the dead, they will believe, and then they won't come into this place of torment. But go ahead.
Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets.
They have who?
Moses
and the prophets. He didn't say the testimony. He said they have Moses and the prophets. Go ahead.
Let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent.
Go ahead.
And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead.
So he's saying, if they will not believe Moses and the prophets, they're not going to believe, even though Jesus rose from the dead. And tomorrow, they know Jesus rose from the dead, but they still don't want to deal with Moses and the prophets. They want to throw that away. So here he's telling you, you've got to have Moses and the prophets, otherwise you will not get away from that dead. All right, we're going to go ahead and look at that a little bit more in Romans the 11th chapter. And we're going to pick this up at verse 1. Romans 11 and verse 1. And this is just to let you know that we still have hope with the Lord. We still have the opportunity to be with the Lord. And we have an opportunity to make it into the wilderness during the Great Tribulation. We just have to know when to flee, that type of thing. But he has always promised to gather Israel, and then he's going to purge out the rebels, and then he's going to set up his new kingdom, or his new kingdom here on earth with the people of like mind. Go ahead. Verse 1.
I say then, have God cast away his people? God forbid.
Go ahead.
For I also am an Israelite, of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin.
So wait a minute. Whoa. This Paul? And Paul is an Israelite? I thought he was a Gentile. And he's of the seed of Abraham, and he's also of the tribe of Benjamin? Huh. I thought he was white. And I ain't kicking against it. I ain't saying that. But I'm just saying, this clarifies that he was an Israelite. Go ahead.
God hath not cast away his people, which he foreknew. Will ye not what the scripture saith of Elias, how he maketh intercession to God against Israel, saying,
go ahead.
Lord, they have killed thy prophets and dig down thine altars, and I am left alone, and they seek my life.
So he's saying Israel done just did everything bad to your word and to your doctrine. Go ahead.
But what saith the answer of God unto him? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal.
So he's saying here, you may think you're the only one out there, and I'm telling you, it's been situations where I thought, I ain't gonna say I was the only one, but I was the only one in my family, only one of my friends. Family would turn the lights off when I knock on the door. Nobody answered my calls. All my friends say, Marcus, he went crazy, man. Don't talk to him. So you're gonna receive that sanctification, but know that you are not alone, okay? Go ahead.
5. Even so then, at this present time also, there is a remnant according to the election of grace.
So according to the election of grace, there is still a small portion that are going to make it in here. And you have to go back to the thought that the road is not broad and wide, but it's straight and narrow, and few there be that make it. And that's why we have such a small amount that are sanctified or separated, set apart from the rest of the world. Only 8 souls survived the great flood, to tell you how serious that is. Population may have been a little bit lower, but that's still a lot of people, a few people, based upon the number I'm thinking that was in place at that time. Go ahead.
And if by grace, then is it no more of works? Otherwise, grace is no more grace. But if it be of works, then is it no more grace? Otherwise, work is no more work.
This can be confusing. I meant to skip this one. I think y'all see that in there. But if you want to talk about it, grace is the free gift that you get. When Adam came and sinned, death fell upon all mankind. That had to be restored. So Jesus had to come and die for the sins of the people in order to return that eternal salvation to you. So that's the grace that you have. Not, it is a free gift, but you still have an obligation to be accountable for that gift. Go ahead.
What then? Israel hath not obtained that which he seeketh for, but the election hath obtained it, and the rest were blinded.
Blinded. Go ahead.
According as it is written, God hath given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see, and ears that they should not hear unto this day.
So that's the way it is. And for some reason, these people just cannot hear or see it. No matter how you read it to them, the light bulb is just not going off. And it's because the Lord have dumbed their mouth. They can't hear it. They can't see it. They can't even relate to it because it's so different from what they've already have. And a carnal mind cannot be subject to God. It just cannot be. All right. You finished that, correct?
Yep.
All right. So let's go ahead and look at this situation of what we were talking about, the lake of fire. This is in Isaiah, the 66th chapter. And a lot of times we use this chapter here to deal with the dietary law. But it also deals with the fact that this is future, and this is something that we're going to be looking at in the future. So those that hide themselves behind a tree in the midst of the garden, eating swine's flesh and the abomination, those are the ones that are hiding behind the tree of Satan, the tree of good and evil, and they are going to get their reward. And what is that going to be? Let's pick this up at verse 5, 66 and 5. Go ahead.
Hear the word of the Lord, ye that tremble at his word. Your brethren that hated you, that cast you out for my name's sake, said, let the Lord be glorified. But he shall appear to your joy, and they shall be ashamed.
So they shall be ashamed, the ones that have come against you. Skip down to verse 8.
Who have heard such a thing? Who have seen such things? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day? Or shall a nation be born at once?
So to all this is going to happen all at one time? Go ahead.
For as soon as Zion travailed, she brought forth her children. Shall I bring to the birth and not cause to bring forth, saith the Lord? Shall I cause to bring forth and shut the womb, saith thy God?
Should I bring her through all this trial and tribulation and then not bring her forth and deliver her? No, that is not what I intend to do. Go ahead.
Rejoice ye with Jerusalem and be glad with her, all ye that love her. Rejoice for joy with her, ye that mourn for her.
This is talking about Israel. Go ahead.
That ye may sup and be satisfied with the breasts of her consolation. That ye may milk out and be delighted with the abundance of her glory.
Go ahead.
For thus saith the Lord, behold, I will extend peace to her like a river, and the glory of the Gentiles like a flowing stream. Then shall ye suck. Ye shall be born upon her sides and be dandled upon her knees.
Go ahead.
As one whom his mother comforteth, so will I comfort you, and ye shall be comforted in Jerusalem.
So the Lord let you know, he's going to set it up in Jerusalem, and you are going to be okay. Go ahead. I think you read.
And when ye see this, your heart shall rejoice, and your bones shall flourish like an herb. And the hand of the Lord shall be known toward his servants, and his indignation toward his enemies.
So the Lord is going to have, he's going to set up, he's going to take care of the enemies, and then he's going to put you in your place and restore Israel to their former glory. Go ahead.
For behold, the Lord will come with fire and with his chariots like a whirlwind, to render his anger with fury and his rebuke with flames of fire.
Go ahead.
For by fire and by his sword will the Lord plead with all flesh, and the slain of the Lord shall be many.
He's going to plead with you, but he's saying here that the slain of the Lord is going to be many. So this is not a situation that everybody is going to just make it. There are going to be some complications here. Go ahead.
They that sanctify themselves and purify themselves in the garden, behind one tree in the midst, eating swine's flesh and the abomination and the mouse shall be consumed together, saith the Lord.
So I think you want to avoid those dishes, right? Okay, move on.
For I know their works and their thoughts. It shall come. Thou will gather all nations and tongues, and they shall come and see my glory.
So they're going to all come and see this thing. Go ahead.
And I will set a sign among them, and I will send those that escape of them unto the nations, to Tarshish, Pul, and Lud, that draw the bow, to Tubal and Javan, to the isles afar off, that have not heard my fame, neither have seen my glory, and they shall declare my glory among the Gentiles.
So it's going to be enough that everybody's going to know that he is the man. Go ahead.
And they shall bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord.
So he's going to bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord. Go ahead.
Out of all nations upon horses, and in chariots, and in litters, and upon mules, mm-hmm. and upon swift beasts, mm-hmm. to my holy mountain Jerusalem, saith the Lord, as the children of Israel bring an offering and a clean vessel into the house of the Lord.
So even if you're not trying to get there, they're going to grab Israel and bring you there, because they're going to finally realize, just like the Israelites figured out that they had killed Jesus, the Gentiles going to finally realize that they made a mistake, and in order to get back with the Lord, we got to deliver the apple of his eye back to him. Some of them ain't going to make it, but they're going to do it. They're going to bring it, because the Lord is going to gather Israel. That is a promise. Go ahead.
And I will also take of them for priests mm-hmm. and for Levites, mm-hmm. saith the Lord.
So he's basically resetting up the same thing he had set up in the beginning when they had everybody in the wilderness. He is the one that set all that up. And he's going to reset up everything once more. Go ahead.
For as the new heavens and the new earth, mm-hmm. which I will make, shall remain before me, saith the Lord, mm-hmm. so shall your seed and your name remain.
So he's saying as the new heaven and the new earth. And there's scriptures that tell you that New Jerusalem, which cometh down like a scroll, is going to come down. We're not going up. It is coming down. Just like the Lord's Prayer said, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass mm-hmm. that from one new moon to another mm-hmm. and from one Sabbath to another mm-hmm. shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord.
So all flesh is going to come and worship before him, saith the Lord, from one Sabbath to another. Not from the first day to the first day, but from the Sabbath to another Sabbath. Go ahead.
And they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me. Mm-hmm. For their worm shall not die, mm-hmm. neither shall their fire be quenched.
Go ahead.
And they shall be an abhorrent unto all flesh.
So at this time, we know this is future, because there is no place right now where we can go and look upon them and look at their flesh and see that they are suffering. But at that time, we will definitely see what is going on. And those are the ones that did what? Transgress against the Lord. So that means you disobeyed him. All right, let's go and finish this. Go to the last scripture, Revelations 22. This is the last book in the Bible. And almost at the end, I don't think I'm going to the very end. Am I going to the end? Let's see here.
Yeah, you are.
I'm going to the end. So we're going to finish this, that's for sure. All right, and we're going to pick this up at verse 12, Revelations 22 and verse 12. Go ahead.
And behold, I come quickly, mm-hmm. and my reward is with me, mm-hmm. to give every man according as his work shall be.
So he says, I will come quickly, and I am coming, and my reward is with me. So nobody's going to get this reward until he comes. So right. Nobody's going to receive anything. At the twinkling of the eye, at the last trump, mm-hmm. all these things are going to be fulfilled. Read 13 for me, please.
I am Alpha and Omega, mm-hmm. the beginning and the end, mm-hmm. the first and the last.
So he is Alpha and Omega. He's the one that started this. He's the one that's going to end it. Basically, as I mentioned before, he called the end from the beginning. This is his baby, basically. All right. Skip down to verse
14.
I actually skipped that.
Okay.
But let's go ahead. We might as well go through it. I think we got some time. Yeah, we got time. Let's do it. 14. Go ahead.
Blessed are they that do his commandments,
uh-huh.
that they may have right to the tree of life.
So they may have right to the tree of life if they do his commandments. Go ahead.
And may enter in through the gates mm-hmm. into the city.
So you got to go in through some gates. And these are not just the pearly gates. These are the gates with mm-hmm. the tribes, the names of the tribes of Israel on them. Three tribes on each gate. All right, go ahead.
For without are dogs mm-hmm. and sorcerers mm-hmm. and whoremongers.
Okay, let's define these. A dog. These are the ones that men like to lay with men. Dogs. Dogs do that. That's why the Lord refers them to dogs. Go, and sorcerers. These are the ones that are doing the predictions in the future, stars reading and so forth. Carrot cards, all of that. And whoremongers, one that just basically, y'all know what that is, going from one to the next. Go ahead.
And murderers, mm-hmm. and idolaters, mm-hmm. and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie.
Some people just love it. They enjoy it because it does taste better, feel better. It just gives them pleasure. Go ahead.
I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches.
Uh-huh.
I am the root and the offspring of David.
Go ahead.
And the bright and morning star.
Uh-huh.
And the spirit and the bride say, and the spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. Mm-hmm. And let him that athirst, that is athirst, come. Mm-hmm. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely.
The eternal life, water of life freely. Go ahead.
For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book.
What book?
This book.
Go ahead.
If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book.
The plagues that are written in this book. So the Lord said, don't add to it, don't take away. So these revised Bibles, the NIV, the New Testament only, they're making all these changes. But the Lord is a powerful God. He is a triumphant God. And I have to believe that he is strong enough and mighty enough and capable to make sure that if I'm going to be judged by this book, that I should be able to have it. It shouldn't be hidden from me. It should be clearly here for me. But the fact of the matter is, I just got to read it.
That's right.
That's my job. Go ahead.
And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy,
mm-hmm.
God shall take away his part out of the book of life,
mm-hmm.
and out of the holy city,
mm-hmm.
and from the things which are written in this book.
Mm-hmm.
He which testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus.
Uh-huh.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen.
Amen.